Right.
Yes,
so,
sir.
So the presentation. Okay. So before I start the presentation, I would like to, you know, give my heart sympathies to the protecting our land. Also to the people injured, to the people who were recovered. We hope that they will recover fast to join the regiment back. The presentation I am making today is essentially on historical details for the current Chinese in India and possible solutions that we can. So we will start with the historical details first. This is the map of Ladakh, eastern Ladakh, and the rest of the western Ladakh. And you can see here that there is a Kunlun mountain range. Kunlun mountain range that goes from the Karakoram Pass. Karakoram Pass is somewhere here, all the way up to east, like this. And then there is the Karakoram range that comes right across here, like this. And then there is a very important range, which is actually a spur of the Karakoram range, that is known as the Laksang range. The Laksang range starts somewhere here and then goes up to this point here. And that is the one that divides the Ladakh portion, the eastern Ladakh portion, into two. One is called the Upper North Soda Plains, and the other one is called the Lingzitang Plains in the south. These are important because some issues that we are going to see later on. And there is Karakash from the north close to the links of the Lang range. And to Jokandra, India, and this is Tibet. So the Laksang range divides as a spur from the Karakoram range into the divides the Ladakh into two portions. And the Kunlun range goes, and the spur of the Kunlun range comes south and joins the south of the Ladakh. So this is the topography of the Ladakh. So if you, with this in mind, if you go back and look at what happened, the Ladakh was always used as the spur of the by the Kashmiris for the Silk Road. They used to go up the river through the Karakoram Pass into Xinjiang and join the Silk Road that was going somewhere here. And the Leh Bazaar was important trade hub, Central Asian trade, Tibet, Kashmir, all these places came to, all these traders came to Leh for trading. So what was happening in region for goods also reached Tibet and Ladakh. These are the reasons why Ladakh is important. The second slide will make more of this historical detail. And you see, this is a very good map that has been around in the web for almost 20 years. You see here, the reason why the Laksak range is such an important range. You can see here the G219 highway that is going on the eastern part of the eastern Ladakh, and the Laksak. If you go to the history, 1865, Johnson, the chief survey of British India at that point of time, did a survey map of the entire Ladakh. But his survey map was too inaccurate because he only this version of Ladakh. He forgot about the other rest of the portion. So he didn't have time to an accurate survey. So that survey government was not used by the British for a very long until 1895. Until 1895. In the 1895, what happened was there was a great game that was going on because the southern expansion of the Russian Tsarist regime, the British wanted to have buffers everywhere around their crown jewel, which was India. And so they wanted a buffer in northwest in Afghanistan, northwestern frontier province, and in Myanmar, what was called the Burma at that point of time. And then through Sinkiang, they expected that the Russian offense through Sinkiang could take place into India. So they wanted to have a buffer in Ladakh region. So they entered into an agreement with the China in 1899 when they offered the McCartney-McDonald line, which was a line which really followed the Laksang range. So the McCartney-McDonald line was offered as a stopgap arrangement to the or as a boundary solution. In fact, they initiated this solution in 1893 through their ambassador in Kashgar to the British. But unfortunately, the Chinese are probably it is always their mindset. They never respond to any suggestions, and they kept quiet for a very, very long time until 1959. By the British, what they did was they thought that this line has been accepted by the Chinese, and they went with this kind of line, a boundary arrangement. But then in 1941, something else happened. The Russians began to come, exert influence in Sinkiang. And because of their influence in Sinkiang, the British felt that they were under pressure in this region. And they changed the boundary line to take this portion. And this portion was the one that has been suggested already by Johnson Ardagh. The Johnson line was extended by Ardagh. Hello? The Johnson line had been already...
Sir,
yeah.
Sorry, sir. Your presentation is not visible on the screen. I think there's some problem with that, so please check that.
It's coming on late.
Okay, it has the same problem again with me.
Yeah, exactly.
Anytime you can continue with this.
I can?
Just go ahead with this, that's all.
Okay, so we will go to slide 2. I don't know whether slide 2 is visible to everyone.
If there is continued problem with the presentation, we can go ahead with the slides.
Right. See what... In 1834, General Zorawar Singh captured Ladakh. I think that is where we branched off. Yeah, so good. So, next bullet, you know, in 1834, General Zorawar Singh captured Ladakh. General Zorawar Singh was the chieftain of the army of Maharaja Gulab Singh. Maharaja Gulab Singh was under the control of the British. So, ultimately, Ladakh was captured by Zorawar Singh, and he also went into Tibet and got killed there. But anyway, Ladakh was eventually transferred to the control of Maharaja Gulab Singh later on when the Sikh Empire led by Maharaja Ranjit Singh collapsed. And at that point of time, Kashmir, Ladakh, everything came together under the control of Gulab Singh. So the Ladakh region transferred from Sikhs to Gulab Singh by the British. So the first survey was done by the chief surveyor of the British Empire at the time, Johnson. But the second survey was done by Ardagh in 1895. What Ardagh did was to take the Kunlun watershed. Kunlun watershed is the upper north portion of Ladakh region as the boundary for Ladakh, entire Ladakh. So in British, that would give the entire Johnson-Ardagh line, which is the one that India has been following since 1947, the whole of Ladakh, eastern and western Ladakh, to India. In 1899, McCartney-McDonald line was formed by the British because the British and the Chinese became friendly. So they decided to give the western half or the northern half of Ladakh, which is the Soda Plains, to the Chinese and claim only the southern half, which is the Limsitang Plain below the Laksang Range for themselves. Karakoram Pass was always the northernmost point of Ladakh, and Pangangso Lake was always the southernmost point of Ladakh. Next slide, please. Okay. So then what happened was, this continued till 1959 when Zhou Enlai wrote a letter to Pandit Nehru saying that they don't accept either the McMahon line or the division of the accession of Ladakh to India. So at this point of time, war broke out and 1962 happened and all those things. And the LAC was formed, the Chinese claim line was formed and all those things. We will get into that later. What are the Chinese motivations today? The Chinese motivations are, in my opinion, to teach India a lesson. In 1962, Mao Zedong was angered by the Indians' support, what he perceived as the support for Dalai Lama in Tibet, or the claim for Ladakh, or Arunachal Pradesh and all those things. And he wanted to teach a lesson. And that is what happened in 1962. Similarly, he wanted to teach a lesson to Vietnam in 1979. So this tendency to teach India a lesson or teach other countries a lesson is something that seems to be in the mind of the Chinese. And the second thing that I think the motivation is to put India in its place, especially after 2008. 2008, in my opinion, is a watershed year. Because the 123 agreement was signed with the United States, and that led to a waiver by the NSG of for India of all the nuclear materials and fuel and technology and all those things. So the Chinese didn't like it at all. At that point of time, China was a very new member in NSG. It was admitted into NSG only in 2004. So they were just 4 years old, and even in any international fora, China was very new to international fora and international diplomacy at that point of time. So they could not do much against India at that point of time. And also, you know, the American President Bush did some heavy lifting by talking to Hu Jintao in the last minute when China was wavering, giving unanimous approval for waiver for NSG to India. And he did some heavy lifting, and then he talked to Hu Jintao, and finally Hu Jintao agreed, and India was given the waiver. All those things rankled the Chinese, and their whole attitude towards India changed at the point of time, in my opinion. They continued to resist, India, the participating nation status in NSG. In 2005, they even started... in 2008, they even started disowning the Wen Jiabao agreement on how to do the boundary settlement, which was based on essentially two principles. One was the settled areas will not be disturbed, and the second was that the geographical features and watershed and all those usual international boundary settlement procedures will be followed. So those things began to change since 2008. And also since 2008, that's a very important change that has happened, which was that, till the point of time, there was a talk going on between India and China about clarifications on LAC. This is different from the boundary level agreement or the boundary level talks that were going on between the special representatives of the two countries. This is just LAC clarification. And that process has come to almost a stop since 2008. And they are not signing on papers and things like that since that point of time. So we can see that 2008 created a big mental block in the Chinese. And the third motivation could be that they want to grab as much real estate as possible during this Wuhan coronavirus time. They are doing this in all areas, East China, South China Sea, Natuna Sea, everywhere. So they are creating problems everywhere. So this could be also as a part of that. And the fourth point could be that the G219 highway that is going through the eastern part of Eastern Ladakh, they would like to have more buffer. The reason why they would like to have more buffer is because there are a lot of standoff weapons. I'm not even talking about missiles. I'm talking about just bombs, the glide bombs, or even very long-range precision artillery fire are coming into play. So 100-120 kilometers can easily be reached by very long precision artillery nowadays, or the glide bombs like Garudma and Garuda that India has developed and successfully tested also. And they can reach G219 highway very easily from within the Indian border. So they want to probably give more buffer to the highway. The highway is still very important for them, connecting the two restive portions or portions which have bigger issues for China, namely Tibet and Xinjiang. The fifth issue could be that they want to settle the border dispute now by either force or by deception, because they have larger goals to pursue. The larger goals are 2035 and 2050 that Xi Jinping has already very clearly given to the Chinese. So they don't want to have lingering disputes with major countries, especially India, and they would like to have a larger Indian market accessed or accessible to them, and they would like to force the border issue now. They could use it as a kind of force to make India accept the Chinese point of view on the border at the boundary, and this could be a pressure tactics. The sixth issue could be that Gilgit-Baltistan is an important point for China, because CPEC goes through that choke point, and the choke point is like the Malacca dilemma for China. So they would like to have more buffer in Gilgit-Baltistan area, and also there has been talk in India of India taking over POK, especially the GB, the Gilgit-Baltistan area. India has started giving weather reports for Muzaffarabad, Skardu, and all those places. Now, so they would think that probably the Gilgit-Baltistan needs to be protected now more vigorously. So that could be one reason to come on the eastern Ladakh area. There's another point which is again curtail India's strategic decision making process and also the tactical decision making process. The strategic decision making process is the expansion or the development of Quad, or the expansion of Quad, and the tackles, the immediate one, which is the chairmanship of the board taken over by India now for another 2 years, and they would not like India to pursue the matter of investigating coronavirus more vigorously. So they would like to put probably on these two issues through their occupation of or advancement in Ladakh. And another very important point is that there's a lot of internal resistance within China, which probably never always comes out, especially about handling of coronavirus, and also especially about India. So they want to deflect the attention from within to outside. And what better choice they have than India, because in 1962 they showed their people that Mao showed to their people that India could be vanquished, and he rode in popularity after that. And so Xi Jinping might also use to employ the same technique now. And again, the ninth issue is there are so many issues that are facing China today. China is hemmed in from all sides by Corona, by trade war, by the 5G issue, Huawei ZTE, Hong Kong economy. All those issues are hemming in China from various sides. And normally the practice, whether in China or in Pakistan, is to raise the national fervor and create a big euphoria and then deflect the attention and take advantage of that situation. And last but not the least is show to the rest of the world, especially the US and its allies, who the hegemon is. They were very gung-ho about saying that the plan was doing exercises in South China Sea and was going on deployment in the Gulf, in the Arabian Sea. Hello? Arabian Sea, etc. Arabian Sea, etc. While the U.S., carriers were docked either in Guam or in Japan or in California, because they were having COVID outbreaks and things like that. And they have been saying that the U.S. will not come to the assistance of their allies if China attacked them. And so this kind of psyops has been going on for a long time. And so they may be thinking of showing to the rest of the world, especially that the US and its allies are in danger, because the US will not come to their help at all. And the Chinese now clearly put, you know, India in the US camp. And that is one reason probably why they want to show the who the hegemon is in this part of the world. And again, like the Chinese technique is always to have multiple reasons for their objectives. So this could be one or more, definitely more of these reasons, other reasons for this going on in Ladakh at this point of time. Next slide, please. Okay. So what are the options now for India? I divide this into three things. One is the short term, medium term, and the long term. Short term, I call it as up to 6 months. If you look at this, the first option that we have is disengage to April 2020 positions, followed by boundary talks. And this is not going to happen for many reasons. China won't accept the status quo ante because they are building a big road in Galwan area. All of us have seen that how the Chinese have channeled the Galwan River and widening the bank of the river to build a road. So they are bringing all the heavy equipment, machinery and everything to build the road. Almost up to the Shayok River meeting point. So I don't think China is going to accept for any disengagement, though we are saying that we are seeing news that, you know, disengagement is happening, but slowly. So followed by boundary talks. Then China will ask what kind of boundary talks. So I don't think this is a short-term option. There is a limited military action possible to push the Chinese back. And that is very much a viable option in my opinion, because we can do that. And this is only a limited action. It's not a war. Then we can have a limited war also to teach China a lesson. But again, this is not going to happen because war is not something that either China or India would like to have. Or we can do a tit for tat in some other place to leverage. This is something we should have done quite a long time back. We should have occupied some places. Every time they came in one place, we should have gone back and occupied some other place to act as a leverage. And that we have not done, except possibly in one or two instances. But I think we should, going forward, we should do it more often. The fifth is economic measures. Some of the economic measures have already been started, like putting on hold 5,000 crore projects worth in Maharashtra, or the Meerut, rapid transit system and things like that. So that is very much a possibility, and we should do that. Propaganda, psyops, and legal warfare, the three W's of China, we should emulate and we should give it back to them in the same way. And this can happen within 6 months' time. And put pressure on China wherever possible. There are so many places where China can be pressured, like, for example, we can say Hong Kong, human rights and things like that. Of course, the Chinese will also say something about India, but we should be prepared for that, because now the Wuhan spirit, the Mamallapuram spirit are all gone, evaporated. So there should not be any niceties or sensibilities and things like that at this point of time. And I would say that one of the important things that we can do straight away is include the Royal Australian Navy in the upcoming Exercise Malabar. We just now have concluded a Lemova-type agreement with Australia, but still we have not indicated whether the Australian Navy will be part of this upcoming Exercise Malabar. But I think we should go ahead and do it immediately. And that will be one of the short-term measures that shows China that we also do mean business when it comes to that. The medium term, I call it as up to 3 years. In the medium term, Gilgit-Baltistan is an important area that we have to concentrate upon. Because the population there is Shia minority, and that Shia minority had never been very convenient with the Pakistanis. And the Pakistanis have been trying to change the demography of Gilgit-Baltistan by bringing in Sunni Muslims from the rest of Pakistan and placing them there and trying to change the demography. So there is a lot of support, a lot of anger against against Pakistan. And also in the Kargil war, it was the Gilgit scouts that suffered the maximum casualties. And there was a kind of mutiny there. And Nawaz Sharif had to go personally, hand over a lot of rewards and, awards to people there in order to win over them at that point of time. So Gilgit-Baltistan is a good province for us to destabilize and probably even take over. When that happens, the Kunjara Pass through Gilgit-Baltistan is effectively blocked and the CPEC would suffer. I know that China will not keep quiet. China would like to come into play at that point of time. But then, this is an issue between Pakistan and India, and China has no locus standi there, and there are options for us available there, even if China comes in. The second is the border area development, which we had neglected for a long time, which has been going on only in the last 5 or 6 years. So these should be accelerated. We have to also co-opt Russia in our efforts against China, which is a very difficult task to do. The Russians are extremely put off by the Western alliance, especially the NATO coming into the eastern borders of Russia at this point of time. So the Russians have a huge issue with the Western alliance, but somehow we have to work, make Russia see the reality. And Russia also has a lot of problems with China because China still continues to claim eastern Siberia as part of China itself. So there are issues that China has with Russia also. So we should work on accentuating these differences and co-opt Russia in our efforts and possibly change the mindset of the NATO alliance, And also we should increase contacts with Taiwan. There is no point in not doing it anymore because if China can do a nuclear material transfer, weapons transfer, missiles transfer to our arch enemy Pakistan and, work towards excluding us from all the international fora and work against our interests everywhere and kill our soldiers, what stops us from increasing our contacts with Taiwan and putting pressure on China in the other way? And also work against Chinese interests. Suspend spirit meetings. The Wuhan spirit and Mamallapuram spirit have all evaporated at this point of time. So this is very clearly a requirement for suspension of all these spirit meetings. And any such spirit meeting should come from Xi Jinping with a sensitivity towards our position so far. So that has to happen immediately. And we should look realistically at Ladakh also. What I mean by looking realistically at Ladakh is the first map that I showed, the Laksan range divides Ladakh into two portions. The G219 highway goes on the other side, the Soda Plain side of the Laksang range. And G219 highway is not going to be given up by China at any point of time. And we don't have a realistic means of taking over the whole of Ladakh from them as well. So like what the McCartney-McDonald line offered in 1899, that Laksang range could still be a possible solution for us. Though from a maximum point of view, we should reclaim the entire Ladakh as ourselves. But we should also look realistically at Ladakh. Next slide, please. Okay. This is a long-term choice for India, that is strengthen alliance against China, solidify world opinions. When I mean strengthen alliance with China, we should realize that China has been an empire. It has never been a nation state. Even today, it is behaving just like an empire. Empires, the sovereignty lies with the emperor or with the oligarchy which is ruling that, or a cabal which is ruling that. Whereas in a nation state, the empire, the sovereignty lies with the people. So this is the big difference between China and India, for example, or with the rest of the ASEAN and other countries. So we should strengthen the alliance against China. And we have to solidify the world opinion. The world opinion is still muted in many cases, even in the coronavirus case. We have to solidify the world opinion. We have to undermine CCP because it is the CCP which is, with the 80 million cadres, is the one that is controlling the 1.4 billion people of China. And aim for democratization of China. And this is something that the National Security Advisor, the Deputy National Security Advisor of the U.S., Matt Pottinger did recently, when he addressed China on two occasions recently. One was on the May 4th revolution anniversary, and the other one was on the taking over by Tsai of the Taiwanese government. And on both these occasions, Matt Pottinger spoke in fluent Mandarin, and his speech was directed at the people of China. He wanted to undermine the CCP at that point of time. This is something we should also try to do. And definitely we should undermine BRI, because BRI is against the interests, against our interests too, not only in China-Pakistan economic corridor, but even otherwise. For example, in Sri Lanka or Burma, Myanmar or Bangladesh, etc. And we should work towards making China implement IT loss arbitration award in SCS. In fact, I would go so far as to say that we should start using ICS, Indo-China Sea, instead of South China Sea, in order to drive the point that, you know, the Indochina is an area. Indochina, by Indochina Sea, I don't mean India and China. I mean the Indochina portion, which is Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos, and those kind of areas, to give prominence to those people also. We have to improve our economy, infrastructure, and military industry there. And reduce dependence on China, which is already beginning to happen. And we are seeing some efforts being taken by India on that score. We have a long way to go, but this is again a long-term plan. And these are the issues that I wanted to bring to your attention, everyone's attention. We can now discuss on this or on many other issues also. Thank you, Purnima. Thank you for presenting.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir, for that comprehensive presentation. The historical perspective, and then move on to why we should do what it is. So we could be wrong, we could be right on our assumptions on why it's doing. But the reasons that you listed definitely are
Sir, please unmute yourself, sir.
Hear me?
Yes, sir. Now I can hear you.
Sorry, I think it, by accident it got muted. Right. So just to say that, in the whole comprehensive presentation, what we got is the historical perspective of what happened during the colonial legacy. And, we have discussed elsewhere to say that when it came to demarcation of boundaries, it was all right for them to demarcate the boundary with Myanmar using the same McMahon line. But over here, because of various reasons where they feel it's disadvantageous to use the McMahon line, they have not accepted it. So both the short-term measures that have been listed and the long-term measures which have been listed are worthy of consideration by the people in power. We already witnessed many of these actions which have been taken, not just by the center, but also by the state governments. We saw Maharashtra government, which has already put this 5,000 crore contract on hold. BSNL has already been told to tweak the contract, not to let Chinese companies in. And likewise, there are many other areas in which there's also a momentum from the masses. You see any social media, people are smashing TVs, destroying mobiles, but that's not going to give you the desired result unless it is supported by a government policy, which decides on how to decouple from China. To think that we can suddenly decouple ourselves from the global supply chain, which has been established by China differently in the last 3-4 decades. So these are points that we must keep in mind. And yes, we are emotional a lot in India. It's good to ensure that this emotional upburst against China is channeled in a particular manner, that the long-term interests of India are well served. So that can only happen if the states and the center work in tandem. So I can also mention one more before I hand over to Rishi. Hope he's ready now. A lot of references were also made to the general who is there, General Zhao Shangqi. Zhang Qui is the spell test, but apparently he is a local hand. He's been in Tibet for a long time, Tibet Autonomous Region, and he knows the entire area like the palm of his hand. And he's been promoted at one stage it was thought that he may be purged from this, but luckily he escaped the purge and now he's become a key man for Xi. And the expectations are that nothing there, what's happened today, would have happened without a green signal from the top leadership in Beijing. So while he's a local man, he would have presented his plans to say that this is an opportune time for India to be taught a lesson. And it will also contribute to their policy of the famous palm and five fingers. That is, the palm is the Tibet, and the five fingers, which are jutting out into Tibet, Sikkim, Ladakh, Arunachal Pradesh, etc. So this is a plan that was put into motion at the time when India was trying to take on the COVID menace. And obviously this has boomeranged and it's hit China back in their face, because there's global condemnation. While people may not say it publicly, except for US, which I said, including in their intelligence report, that it happened at the behest of the Chinese commander, and the violence that was engaged in on 15th, resulting in 20 deaths on our side and many more areas, is something that has told China that India cannot be pushed over. There's a phenomenal amount of air activity that's taking place. The Apaches, the MiGs, the Sukhois are all in the forward bases. So we have said the right kind of, the Navy is in the Straits of Malacca, Singapore, operating out of Port Blair. And the Army, right, likewise, the ITBP and others have also been activated. So we are not to gloss over any of the phases of this war that has taken place. You can call it a local engagement, but there are many lessons for us, including the so-called surveillance capability of India. We need to question this during the question answer session, because we have the DIPAC, which looks at the different satellite. We have excellent high resolution satellites which have been launched by us in ISRO. You know, some of them are centimeter capability, and yet how is that we missed out on this massing of the troops along the border? One reason is that everybody took it for granted that it's a summer exercise, and therefore perhaps there was a degree of complacency that set in without realizing that at the end of the exercise the same effort can perhaps be diverted along the border for this misadventure of China. So I think we have failed in reading the signals, and perhaps we need to work together, whether it is NTRO or whether it is all the inputs that come from DIPAC and other intelligence agencies, and including our interim agencies, and the border. The border, there is a lot that's being given by these people. Maybe we fail to see the signals, and it was rightly brought out by Abhishek Sridharan, we should have also done likewise. How is that we always allow China to keep on saying that it's perceptual difference, we don't know where the border is? Use the same logic, same argument to go and occupy their borders and say we don't know where it is. So our troops have occupied this, which gives you a certain amount of ability to negotiate in such cases. There are some good signs today, because the marathon meeting that took place at the core commander level, which went on, I believe, up to 12 hours, is at least now there's been some promise to say that they will disengage. But, we are very fond of saying trust but verify. So, in the case of Chinese, neither can you trust nor can you verify, because there are very mixed signals that will be sent, and they'll pretend that they're withdrawing, but they'll be amassing their troops elsewhere. So, there are serious issues there, and if you've not learned now, I think we are not going to learn ever. So also there is a small comment on the comments that was made by Modi, the political leadership. Unfortunately, that was one occasion where Modi lost out at an opportunity to take the nation into confidence. All that was to be done was, because it led to a lot of confusion and taking back the words that he was said, clarifications being given by PMO. I mean, that's not the way you want a mature democracy to function. So I'm sure the Prime Minister, the PMO have learned their lessons, because there were contradictory messages that were being put out by MEA, by the Rajnath Singh Ji, and then on the day of the address, as if nothing happened. That was the impression one got when you heard the Prime Minister's speech. So I'm sure that he also would have learned that it's better to come clean and say, yes, the Chinese have come in, they betrayed our trust, we are handling them, we are pushing them back. Was something perhaps that would have been better received instead of saying we're not given 1 inch and you know Chinese are not anyway. So, or he could have qualified by saying that after this standoff that took place on 16th, this is the situation that we have achieved by using our forces. We taught the Chinese a bloody lesson. And, you know, in fact, today, I think within our group, a lot of these messages have been shared where the Chinese citizens are very angry and they are quoting Indian example of saying, see how they treated their soldiers who lost their lives. And here we are not even acknowledging the sacrifice made by the PLA Navy soldiers. So this is where transparency helps. We've lost some people, have the grace to admit that we lost them. Also, there is a lot of misinformation that went on, saying that 10 people were kept in custody and etc. This has also been clarified. But obviously, the government did not want to endanger the people, the lives of people who were in custody at that time. Apparently, at that time, we also had some high-profile officers in our custody. So they were trying to use this as a negotiating instrument, and therefore a lot of this was not in the domain. So I thought I'll pitch in with some of these observations on the talk, and we can have a question answer session after Rishi Athreya has finished his presentation, if he's ready. Rishi, are you ready?
Rishi sir, please unmute yourself sir in your phone.
Hello, yes, sir. Am I muted yes, now?
Yeah, you're audible. You're audible.
I'm audible. Yeah. Very good. Can I start sharing my screen?
Yeah, sure. Good yes, time. All yours.
Sir, thank you very much. Thank you very much, Commodore. If I may start my presentation with some, notwithstanding some IT glitches here, I'm here and I'm starting my presentation. So if I may start, the first point that I come to, as we say, is what are we discussing today? We are discussing today the Galwan incident, the incident that happened in, which was supposed to have happened first on the 5th of May and later on the 17th of June near the Pangong Lake in the Galwan Valley in the Ladakh region of India, the Union Territory of Ladakh. Now to give a map to show where, this map is taken from BBC, so pardon the words like Pakistan administered Kashmir, India administered Kashmir. Maybe this is just a matter of convenience. So please have a look at the map. And after the map, okay, you've seen the map now. Now the first question is, what is the issue between India and China? For a start, there's a long-standing border issue and that has a colonial legacy. And the border has never been really defined. Now both countries have their own concept of where the border lies. And there are of course 20 points really where the borders differ. And Pakistan accepts China accepts the 1959 border and India accepts the 1962 border. And there was an agreement in 1993 to have at an operational level solve such situations. But clearly China honors these more in the breach than in the observance. And the ostensible reason for the current problem is supposed to be because of the attack at Daulat Beg Oldie. And of course, there are varying attacks of the land warfare reason. But this presentation would look at the larger geopolitical implications. Yes. First of all, what is China's problem with the LAC? It's an undefined colonial legacy. Then there have been the 59 and 6, and the protocols have not been honored. The next is the proximate cause, as we've seen, is this. Now, China's main issues, first of all, are territory capture. China has an old habit of capturing unclaimed zones. Then China engages in coercive diplomacy, particularly with smaller countries. But this is clearly not going to be possible with a big country like India. Then China engages in counter-containment, particularly where it finds it's being encircled. In the instant case, China thinks India is encircling it by its alliance with Japan and USA. China thinks it can build pressure on India by using this as a bargaining chip. But China effectively seeks tactical gain with India and wants to be a leader in a unipolar Asia. And another problem for China is that COVID-19 and its wolf warriors have clearly damaged its credibility. So by expansionist posturing, it hopes to improve its standing, but clearly that's backfiring. Now, what should India do? There's been a lot of discussion on this. Commander Vasan himself made a video there's a deep sense of outrage, and India wants an immediate military response. As Commodore Rawson said, China is a barbaric nation. There is a school of thought that believes India is appeasing China. This appeasement is the kind that Neville Chamberlain did towards Hitler in 1939. There have, of course, been airstrikes on Pakistan and the Balakot airstrikes. But, of course, in the case of China, the balance of power being less favorable to India, such airstrikes or surgical strikes are not an option, and the worst-case scenario is a nuclear threat. Yes, coming to the next, going further, India has considered diplomatic negotiations. There's been little progress. Russian mediation was suggested. This has been politely declined. And India effectively has had a tactical deterrent against China, which has clearly been ineffective. Now, some people talk about an economic boycott, but that too is not going to be possible. The next point which comes to is, who are India's allies? India has followed a position of strategic autonomy. This is similar to the old Dawn alignment. But of course, India has to align with like-minded countries. And India got aligned with the USSR in 1961 after the 62 and 65 wars. And this event is seen as India's shift from idealism to realism. And Chinese belligerence makes it more necessary for India to need allies. And the Quad has been quite supportive of India. As in the words of the Lieutenant General Prakash Menon, China must mentally accept that India will never be in any camp, but depending on the context and issue at stake, it will sit in the same tent with nations having common interests. This should be India's game plan. Then, having said that, India itself faces governance challenges. There is no foreign policy white paper. Politicians are clearly not very good at this. But there are official doctrines by various branches of the Indian Armed Forces. And if one looks at the Armed Forces doctrine, these can be the guiding principle. And on the governance issues, another problem is there is poor integration between civil and military forces in India, which is another reason for a poor response. Now, what can be the conclusion? China is politically and militarily unreliable. Pressurizing is counterproductive. The present situation can be considered a new Cold War or Cold War II. In India, there's a gap between rhetoric and action. The way forward is India has to build more political, show political will, build alliances, give an economic response, improve civil-military relations, and consider joint operations between the armed forces. Thank you very much, Commodore Rawson, Chair, for the opportunity to have presented this. The views in this presentation are of the speaker and should not be attributed to Asia Center Bangalore or Chennai Center for China Studies. I commend this presentation to the webinar. Jai Hind.
Thank you, Rishi. It complements well with what Sridharan presented earlier. So I'm sure there'll be questions on this. Just one or two points on what you said. The slide that you showed about the quote of General Menon is a valid one. We are clearly not going to be aligned with any country, but we will continue to align with issues. And therefore, as he said correctly, don't be surprised if you are sitting in the same tent. Which has like-minded people. So that is good. On the economy, we already discussed this earlier when Sridharan made his presentation. There are short-term measures which are possible, and there are long-term measures which we must thoroughly think over. There can't be knee-jerk reactions on this. As was said, if China has worked very hard for the last four decades to establish a global supply chain, which revolves around the China's capability, its manufacturing ability, how can you suddenly delink yourself? But that's not something that's going to happen overnight. We need to work towards this, sitting in that tent that you spoke about, arriving at many mechanisms which will ensure that there is a parallel or an alternate global supply chain, which now removes the dependence, total dependence on China. The pharmaceuticals which we looked at earlier is something like 46% that comes in from China. So we know what our weaknesses are, and this should be looked at as an opportunity that helps us to recalibrate our responses in terms of the post-COVID world order, as well as our own policies that we need to shape. So there are plenty of lessons here. So your presentation must be seen along with the presentation made by Sridharan, and then we must draw our lessons. In the meanwhile, let me also welcome Admiral Ganesh, my former boss from Cochin. He was the Flag Officer Commanding in Chief, Southern Naval Command, and now the Chief Staff was our operations. I'm very happy to see you here, sir, and hearty welcome to this dialogue. And I'm sure we'll get a chance to listen to you for a few minutes during the question answer session. Thank you for being with us, Admiral Ganesh. Yeah, now, Sridharan, would you like to now take on these questions?
Sure, yes.
Yeah, before that, I'll ask Colonel Hariharan to chip in and, you know, make his points on this standoff. Colonel Hariharan.
Sir, please unmute yourself, sir.
He's gone somewhere?
No, sir. Please unmute yourself, sir. Colonel Hariharan, sir, please unmute yourself, sir. No, sir, you're not audible, sir. You just have to unmute yourself, sir. It's muted, sir. You're muted, sir.
Hari, sir, you're muted. Please unmute yourself. We can't hear you. We can't hear you. Please unmute yourself. Yeah, now we can speak.
You see, I would like to take it in two parts. One is the tactical aspect. The other is the strategic aspects based on what we have seen. I was going through, you know, in 2012, the 50th anniversary of the 1962 attack, Bhima Chalani wrote a paper on Chinese strategy, the principles of Chinese war making, he called it. It was published in Newsweek, I remember. I found this thing very relevant to the current status. There are some basic principles of war which China follows. One is, of course, what we call the surprise. The China always does this strategic surprise and striking when we are the weakest. And that leads us to the availing. Always China holds the initiative in all incidents. Why it is happening, we should examine and take tactical measures. Even in this case, I think you very rightly pointed out, there is this in April itself, we knew that the Chinese were carrying out exercise. And the exercise was well publicized as part of the psychological warfare Chinese do it across the board. That is one aspect. Still, we are complacent. You see, we are rushing to Moscow and to get the armament. We are negotiating for AK-47 prices. This kind of thing. So this leads us to second aspect of China. You see, in 2017, I think, if I remember correct, they implemented this civil-military coordination plan. I think it's a five-year plan. They started implementing where all civilian, industrial, research, innovation, and discoveries are coordinated with defense requirements. So that there is a very large converged effort on making, improving defense capability and self-reliance. We must do this immediately. We have been talking about this for so long, last 10, 12 years. We have been able to achieve it to some extent in shipbuilding. Even there are a lot of glitches. In artillery manufacture, it has taken us 18 years, we've been talking about it. These are examples which we can easily emulate. Third is the American 2019 Pentagon report to the Congress on China mentions one aspect, which I think is the coordination of PSYOPs in target countries. You must have seen recently how they have been financing all the well-known popular media in the US, which influence public policy by buying space. I am not saying we should go around buying space in Pakistan and in China, but what we say is we should have a counter narrative. Even to this day, we have not officially stated what really happened sequence-wise. We must get into this culture of immediately having a press meet or whatever it is, or through the social media. We should keep the people informed. China does this. Even negative statements, China immediately makes a statement. So I think we should coordinate our act. I think Rishi very correctly pointed out there is a total lack of coordination of decision-making process between the civilians, between the defense ministry and the army and the command also. ITBP is under home ministry and army is deployed. Though there are rules when they come under command of the troops on place. So a lot of these, what you call bureaucratic glitches, I think this we should use this opportunity and we do away with this. I think I will leave it at this. There are many other issues. These are the doables. Same thing applies to the Chinese products. I think we should show a very strong signal. I entirely agree with you. We will be financing PLA's expansion through our trade. I think TCA Ramajam has written a very nice paper I came across, how it can be done. So we should identify, make a structured plan based on time-based schedule and implement it. We do the doables immediately and have a long-term projection and implement. Thank you.
Vasan sir, please unmute yourself, sir. We are not able to hear you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Colonel Hariharan, for all those inputs which are there. Admiral Ganesh, sir, can you hear me? Admiral Ganesh, sir, can you hear me?
He has to unmute himself, sir.
I'm not sure if he's heard me. Sir, you need to unmute yourself.
I think his connectivity is stuck.
No problem. Okay, let's go on with the question answer session now. And people may just identify themselves and then indicate who that question is pointed towards and be very brief. Please do not make long statements. The floor is open only for questions, pointed questions, brief, short, and also addressed to the person by name.
Sir, I would like to ask the first question, sir. My question is to this is Bala Subramanian, Research Officer C3S. My question is to Vasan sir and Colonel Hariharan sir. So the question is, what is that China is trying to gain by not letting out the number of counts, the losses that they have had in the Galvan Valley incident? And what is the psychological aspects of this whole issue, sir? Thank you, sir.
I think for that, you need to understand the Chinese system. As I brought out in my response, you know, they are wary about bringing out this figure. But the official line that was told was that we do not want to give the number because it will raise sentiments on both sides. Now, this is the official line. You know, in the MAA spokesperson, they said, we are not making the casualty figures public because it can give rise to raise tensions on both sides. This is the official line. But even locally, while we went ahead with, the complete coffins being carried and state honors being given in all the states, announcing various awards and cash awards. And in the case of Telangana, the wife of Colonel Babu has also been given a deputy collector's job. So, you know, this is the way we have dealt with the those who suffered, in this hand-to-hand combat. So it is the Chinese system that likes to wait and see what the responses are. And obviously, like I said, the cultures are very different. you know, here we even celebrate the valor even when they have given up their lives as martyrs. And whereas the same culture is not seen, it happened even in Pakistan. You saw it in Kargil, where they did zone the bodies. They did not even come and claim the bodies. Which is, this is a kind of culture. You know, we respect those who given up their lives. And in the, both Pakistan and China, they don't appear to care about the loss of lives. And while they give a lot of official excuses to say why they did not share these figures with us. Harisa, would you like to add? Please unmute yourself. So please unmute yourself.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I think you are correct. We should not confuse. India is a democracy. Anybody can go wrong saying anything. In China, it is not. It is a communist regime. So state media is controlled. So all avenues of public communication are monitored. So they will, 62 war, I wonder whether there is any official data published in by China. I haven't come across. There are various guessworks. They have never published. Tiananmen Square incident also, there is a conflicting data. So it is, as you very rightly said, the Commodore said, it's a part of the communist culture, monolithic party ruling the country. That's all.
Thank you, sir. Sridharan, would you like to say something?
Yeah, exactly. You know, I totally agree with what Commodore Wasson said about the honor and dignity based countries. I see two examples right in front of us. One is Pakistan and the other one is China. In Vietnam War or in 1962 war or now, China is not accepting many casualties at all. What kind of a country is one which doesn't even honor its fallen soldiers? This is something beyond comprehension here. And also one more point is that treachery is also one important aspect of China. For example, even in Galwan Valley, after an agreement has been made for disengagement, treacherously we were ambushed by Chinese soldiers. So all these aspects make me feel always that China and Pakistan are made for each other. Thank you.
Rishi, would you like to say something? Rishi,
sorry, you want me to comment on why China didn't acknowledge its dead? Is that the question?
Yeah.
Well, I think it's, one is because they don't want to be seen as having suffered casualties. And there may be dissensions within their ranks. And secondly, probably they're a secretive state. And they don't want to, and so clearly they want to hide the truth like they did even with the number of casualties in Wuhan. And now they have a second outbreak in Beijing, but nobody really knows how many COVID patients there are in China. Their claims that it's been controlled can't be believed. Nothing coming out of China can be taken as face value. If the old Eastern Bloc was the old Iron Curtain, China is the new Iron Curtain. Quite simple. Thank you.
Thank you, Rishi. May I now request the answers who are here to pose their question? We can ask them. Sandeep, go ahead.
So it's not a question, is it? Okay, it's a short comment rather.
Yeah, go ahead. Keep it brief.
Yeah. While we must strongly resist and protect our borders, we should also focus on building the political clout internationally and rebuild our economy to back the capabilities of our armed forces. Our primary focus must be to reset our ties with our immediate neighbors. This will include Nepal, Bhutan, Myanmar, Bangladesh, and Sri Lanka. We must stop playing the big brother role with our neighbors and fulfill our commitments. We must take advantage of our cultural ties with these countries. India does not celebrate Buddhism the way we celebrate Hinduism. An example for it is the state of tourism and facilities for pilgrimage around the Buddha circuit. India must claim patronage over all forms of Buddhism around the world. We must ensure that the Buddhist monasteries in our borderlands are strongly backing our claims. Internationally speaking, India must focus on achieving a defense pact with Indonesia and Vietnam, which should be similar to the US-Japan agreement. We should not get into into a partnership with the Western forces. Rather, we must work with them on a case-to-case basis. Getting into a partnership with the US has its own disadvantages which are equally important to be considered. These actions should be the way forward for India while continuing ties with China bilaterally and multilaterally. We should engage with China in forums such as SCO, AIIB, etc. India must take constructive measures to check the trade deficit and look at improving relations with China while projecting a strong will to protect our interests by taking these steps. Yes, sir. That's it, sir.
Thank you. Two important points from your response. One is about the inability to manage our neighborhood, which is a very unfortunate thing to have happened. We saw how Nepal under Prime Minister Oli, has even changed their map. And they are, virtually in the Chinese camp. But this morning you saw the report yesterday and today that China has engrossed into some of their villages to build some bridges and some roads. So China, does not even, as the smaller neighbors who have been used with money and investment have not learned their lessons. Here it comes in as a benevolent nation which is investing, but at the end of it, it takes over the assets of a small economy. Whether it's Hambantota in Sri Lanka or whether it is now some of the villages that have been reported to be used by China for building roads and connectivity. So I think we have to really hard sell our soft power, like you said, the cultural connect, the religious connect that we have. And unfortunately, we have not been able to manage our neighborhood. But that's a big challenge. We have made statements to say neighborhood first. We have said neighborhood first, but you need to be able to walk the talk in terms of keeping your facilities, giving all your, we did try to give up our satellite for city planning, for water management, for flood control, etc. Unfortunately, luckily, others have accepted that Pakistan became a stumbling block here. On your point about aligning with the West, as was also brought out in Rishi's presentation, we are going to align with our interests and its issue base. Not because, we are going to have, but you must also see the signs here. Just as Azhar Masood, prescription was stopped by China, Pakistan, had tabled a resolution for the prescribing Vodafone for engineers who were working in Afghanistan. Who rescued you? It's America. America has stalled this. So, some of these which are issue-based, you need to be continued to be used. So, when you have already been working on your strategic partnership with USA, which has released the high-tech weapons, which is supporting you on the NSG, and it's now holding your hand. So, mutually beneficial. We're not going to say we are aligned with USA and we signed, become another NATO country with USA, but where is the issue based, we must continuously use the power of another country which has the veto power. It has used it effectively. Sri, would you like to comment on this?
I think Sandeep made excellent points. I would agree with him on two of those points, which is one, the Buddhism circuit. The Buddhism circuit is something which we have totally neglected, and we could have gained in enormous soft power with that kind of for Buddhist circuit. The second one is about what you also rightly said about the neighboring countries, which we have a good policy, neighborhood policy, but unfortunately it is not seen on the ground. But one point which I would like to say is that, when you have a strong country like a very powerful country like China as an enemy, today China is an enemy. There is no two points about that. We should not beat about the bush. When China is an enemy, then we need some support. We are not going to get that support from Vietnam and Malaysia and Indonesia and all these countries, which of course we should encourage. But we have to have solid support from the US, and obviously whenever we have a support from a country like US or even Russia, which when we had to give in something also to them, back to them. Otherwise there is no alliance at all or no cooperation, no need for them to help us in any way. So something will be done, but that should not be seen as being in their, being in their alliance or in their camp or whatever. It's a case-to-case basis, as Rishi also said earlier. Thank you.
Thank you. Admiral Ganesh, are you online, sir? Would you be able to comment? Admiral Ganesh? I don't think the audio is okay. So it's all right. Harish, sir? American neighborhood and neighborhood, land neighbors, Nepal, Bhutan. Harish, sir?
Na on Nepal, I had.
Okay, hear you. Go ahead.
On Nepal, I would like to add this issue, this Lipulekh dispute, had been pending for a long time. A joint survey was carried out for 7 years. After that, both have not ratified. You see, these are issues which should be prioritized and pressurized. Same thing with the aid. You know, when the Nepal was suffering from a deadly earthquake, this Madhesi movement blocked the traffic. And everybody in Nepal accuses India of encouraging Madhesis, because they are Madhesis are nothing but Biharis who belong to that region, Madhes. So we should have a long-term strategy to integrate Nepal. All our projects are pending for various bureaucratic issues. Nepalese bureaucracy, even Chinese are finding it very difficult to tackle. But we should be better at it because we have a very long relations. We also think like them, I suppose, culturally. So we should prioritize these countries, Nepal, Bangladesh, and Sri Lanka. To my mind, these three are strategically most indispensable. So the Nepal is surrounded by three sides by India, just like Bangladesh. So ultimately, they have to make space for India in their foreign policy, however much China can help. I remember President Rajapaksa, Mahinda Rajapaksa, was telling me that you are here 30 kilometers across, whereas China is 2,000 kilometers away. So you are family, China is a friend. So you see, we should cultivate these countries by any means and have them to at least basically think of our interest also, not only their interest. I think this is where, as regards this measure, there is always an anti-Indian element in these small countries. We are not acting like Big Brother at all. I'm sorry to disappoint, Sandeep, that used to be the case. Now we are not acting at all. Forget about the Big Brother. We are not acting. So we have given space in Nepal politics also to China to intervene. Earlier we refused even Americans to intervene. So I think we need to focus on neighborhood first. I agree on these three countries, and Indian Ocean is a separate subject. We will take it up separately.
Ashik, would you like to come in? Ashik? Is he there, Ashik?
Sir, I have a question for Sridharan sir.
Go ahead.
Sir, in your presentation as well as in your talk, you have mentioned about Russia, sir. Currently, looking at the current of the kind of interdependence and everything, I would even go beyond that and say the kind of dependence that Russia has on China. Do you think Russia can do the kind of maneuver that it used to do with India in 1970s?
Yeah, that's a good question, Bala. You know, but you know, in diplomacy, you never give up hope. That's one thing. The second point I would like to say is, in as late as 2016 or 2017, there was a big problem between Russia and China because the Chinese wanted to use the Arctic route for their transshipment, and they know it's Soviet Union. Russia is the one that is controlling the route, and so there was a big tiff between them. And in 2013 or 2014, China objected to Russia doing oil exploration in South China Sea. And you know, in 2013, when Xi Jinping made his first trip to China, Moscow, that was his very first trip outside of China after becoming the president. The trip he chose was to Moscow. And just before he left for Moscow, there was a huge protest in front of the Russian embassy in Beijing, saying that Russia is keeping Eastern Siberia and is the biggest country which has taken the biggest amount of land from China. The second biggest is India, and the third biggest is Kazakhstan. So all these claims were made, and there was riot and stone throwing and things like that that happened in Beijing. So all is not well. Of course, today, because of the NATO expansion eastwards and at the borders of Russia, Russians are very unhappy about that, and there are so many issues between US and Russia. But we should work towards at least Russia seeing our point of view as far as China is concerned. Even if we cannot change the mindset of Russia with respect to US, that is not our problem anyway. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Add Bala is that we saw the present development, including the so-called RIC, Russia-India-China meeting, where clear signals were sent out by India, where our defense minister even refused to have a one-on-one meeting with his counterpart. So that's one signal. And Russia has been quite categoric to say that India and China are capable of sorting out this difference themselves, so it is not going to be a party. Remember, Russia also a huge market. As far as we are concerned, we are still importing a phenomenal amount of aircraft, ships, weapon systems, Brahmos, S-400. The amount of engagement that we have with Russia is phenomenal. They are not going to just say anything anti-India, because it's a question of a huge market. Likewise, even America has said India and China, Trump offered to mediate at one stage. Thereafter, it's been left to these two countries to sort out. And the developments yesterday, day before, has told us that yes, we can disengage on terms mutually agreed after the marathon meeting. But none of us are here in a mood to oblige China in terms of what it promises on one hand and what it does on the other hand. So the factor of trust and verify is something that cannot be applied to China, because neither can we trust, as I said earlier, or we can verify what its true intentions are. But we need to be very cautious in our approach. Use Russia, use America to serve our interests. And obviously, they're not going to come here just to help you out. They're going to be here where there is convergence of interests. That's why the issue of non-aligned meet or the strategic autonomy comes into it. Any questions from the youngsters?
Mr. Siddharth Subramanian wanted to say something in the comments he's asked.
Sure. Please go ahead, Mr. Siddharth.
Okay, there are a few points that I would like to mention. First of all is that all politics is local, meaning to say that any aggression shown by a country towards another country, border configurations, etc., etc., are a part and parcel of local politics. If we look at the Chinese aggression in India in 62, it was also a part of local politics. Mao's Great Leap Forward had failed, and he used India as a case to divert attention from all the rhetoric Mao was facing from the local population. About 16 million people had died. Now in India, we have to understand what is the local scenario with regards to what is happening between the Chinese population and its perception of the current dispensation, that is the Xi dispensation in China. Why is China being so aggressive when the entire world is reeling under a pandemic and nearly 500,000 lives have lost? So this is something that has to be understood very clearly. Second is, China is, a treacherous country, and, they are hitting us when we are down, etc., etc. But I feel domestically, China is very clear on its foreign policy objectives. We are not clear. That is very, very clear. Our foreign policy objectives vis-a-vis our neighbors is not clear. We had a huge leverage with Nepal, being the only existing Hindu kingdom, etc. We have lost that also. How did that happen? Who got paid in Nepal for the tune to change to this level? I think we can pay the Nepalese back also in money if that is so required. The third point I would like to say is that the messaging is one of the most important aspects that Chinese understand. We have to create the right messaging to reach the Chinese. We have to reach the Chinese people so that once the Chinese people are understanding what India is thinking, they will question their government. This is how you get back at China. So these are the few points that I would like to highlight when we are discussing China. I mean, it's all, you know, and another question, the last point that I would like to make is that this whole element of perception, you know, this is what we perceive the LAC to be, that is what they perceive. Let us remove that. This is what we think is the LAC ought to be, and that we stick with it, come what may. This is how you call the Chinese bluff. That is what I feel, and those are the points I would like to make. Thank you.
I have some questions from the youngsters. So the point you made particularly about perception about the border is very valid. Yes. We've had 22 meetings, and the Chinese have still not told you where they think the border lies. This is subterfuge.